A very big hello to all my dear students. I'm Dr. Ruchi Rai. Today, let's discuss this fundus slide. So, whenever you are going to get any fundus slide, a very important thing is first look at can you see the disc or not? If I can see the optic disc, I'm looking at the central retina, okay? And if I'm not able to see the optic disc, I'm looking somewhere in the periphery. We always see the disc first, we see the macular area, and then whatever the rest of the fundus is visible to you. If you keep that always in mind, you'll never make a mistake. Further describing how to think about a fundus slide. In the disc, there are only three major things that we see. What is the margin? What is the color? And what is the CD ratio, if applicable, cup disc ratio? Okay? Now, when you come to this fundus slide, of course, we can see this optic disc, right? What do you see around the disc here? This is what is annular crescent. This is a gray shadow-like area around the disc. This is your annular crescent. If you see at the bending of the blood vessels, the cup disc ratio is normal. Now coming to the macular area, nothing much significant except that I see these white lines. Can you see those white lines here? What are these white streaks? These white streaks are nothing but due to excessive stretching of the retina. So what are we looking at here? Let me first give you the diagnosis. It's a slide of pathological myopia. And why we are saying that? First of all, the first point in favor is this annular crescent. And the biggest point, I'll talk about these white streaks a little later. The next biggest point is, can you see these blood vessels, those prominent blood vessels here? These are all these blood vessels, these prominent, they are not retinal, they are choroidal. So when a choroidal, when the retina is so thinned out due to excessive stretching of the axial length, these prominent choroidal blood vessels, this is what is called tegroid fundus, okay? Or we can also call it tessellated fundus. So it is either tegroid or tessellated fundus. What is the next important feature coming back to these white streaks? Can you see this? These white streaks. These are break in the Bruch's membrane. We call them lacquer cracks. Now, when you talk about break in Bruch's membrane, there are two terms which we use for this. One is lacquer cracks, which is seen in pathological myopia. It is due to overstretching of the retina and the membrane due to the excessive axial length. The second term is angioid streaks. Angioid streaks are also break in the Bruch's membrane, and this is seen in collagenous disorders. What is the most common cause of angioid streaks? It is pseudoxanthoma elasticum. Please remember this. I think it was one of your very previous questions. Okay, so most common cause can be pseudoxanthoma elasticum. We should have expected something in the macular area. Yes, we are not able to see in this slide very prominently, but due to the stretching, there can be pigment clumping and hemorrhage at the macula, which you call Foster-Feud spots. Okay, these are Foster-Feud spots. Let's see the next slide. Again, the same pathological myopia. Of course, in this fundus slide, I don't see the disc. I'm looking at the periphery of the retina. And what do you see here? What is all this? This is all degenerative change in the retina. Typically, in pathological myopia, this is what we call lattice degeneration. Okay, so what you're now looking at here is lattice degeneration. And of course, it can degenerate and degenerate, and in few patients can also lead to hole formation, leading to rhegmatogenous retinal detachments. Rhegma means break in the continuity of the retina. Okay, so when it is after a degeneration, it is a hole. When it is due to traction, it is a tear, which is typically horseshoe shape. So here what I see is a lattice degeneration, which if we don't take care of, may proceed, we should keep following up, may proceed to hole formation, and that can also lead to retinal detachments. I hope you all are clear. Retinal detachment is separation of outermost layer, that is the retinal pigment epithelium, from the neurosensory retina. Okay, one more finding which I would like to mention, very important, many times asked in exams as well. So when this eyeball is extending, 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 it can become ectatic at the back, which is called posterior staphyloma. So very important feature here is for pathological myopia is posterior staphyloma. Okay, so if we list out what are the features we see, I'm again revising for you all. We see the annular crescent around the disc. We may see posterior field spots. The fundus is tessellated or tigroid fundus due to prominent choroidal blood vessels, right? And then we can see the lacquer cracks. We can see posterior staphyloma. And at the periphery of the retina, what we see here is lattice degeneration, which may lead to rheumatogenous retinal detachment. So actually, there are a lot of questions on pathological myopia. You have seen there are questions on lattice, there are questions on posterior staphyloma, there's question on posterior field spots. So it's a very important topic. Hope it's absolutely clear to you. This is what is, and of course, when you define pathological myopia, generally per se, we don't exactly mention, okay, this much power or this much of myopia is pathological. Any myopia with fundus changes is pathological myopia. But of course, common sense, it has to be very large numbers because then only there's excessive length of the eyeball, stretching of the retina leading to all these changes. Hope it's absolutely clear to you all. What are the features of pathological myopia? Thank you so much. Stay blessed.